Welcome to the Politicrat. I'm Omar Moore. It is Wednesday, April the 21st, 2021. On this edition of the Politicrat, M’khia Bryant, 16 years of age, murdered by Columbus police in Ohio. During the time the verdict of guilt in the Derek Chauvin murder trial was being read out. More about this heinous, cowardly murder right after this.
There are days, this is one of them, when you wonder what your role is in this country and what your future is in it. Mm-hmm. How precisely you're going to reconcile yourself to your situation here, and how you're going to communicate to the vast, heedless, unthinking, cruel white majority that you are here. I'm terrified at the moral apathy, the death of the heart, which is happening in my country. These people have deluded themselves for so long that they really don't think I'm human. I have basis on their conduct, not on what they say. And this means that they have become, in themselves, moral monsters.
M’khia was named after a male prophet in the Bible. She was a very loving, peaceful little girl. She was 16 years old. She was an honor roll student. And M’khia had a motherly nature about her. She promoted peace. And that's something that I want to always be remembered.
That was Paula Bryant, the mother of M’khia Bryant. Yesterday, speaking to a local television reporter, I believe it was Lacey Crisp, of a news station in the Columbus, Ohio area. You cannot even have a few moments of relief over a guilty verdict for a killer cop who murdered George Floyd, who executed and tortured to death George Floyd, without another killer cop killing another one of us. I don't care what the circumstances were. The story goes, M’khia Bryant had a knife and she was lunging at someone. She was about to stab someone. So the cop from the Columbus Police Department shot and killed her. Four times? Four gunshots? To the chest? Number one. Number two. M’khia Bryant called for the police. M’khia Bryant was the one who called 911. she apparently was going to be attacked by a couple of girls. So in self-defense, she had a knife. Police arrive and they go and blow her away. They kill her. I know that if this were a white girl trying to fend off two other white girls from attacking her, and the white girl had a knife, and that white girl was using that knife as self-defense, as clearly M’khia Bryant was doing, I know that that white girl would still be alive. And you know that that white girl would still be alive. All of us know that. Every single one of us know that. Anyone listening to this episode right now, listening to me right now, knows that. I'm telling you, I think, again, every single fact is not known to me, but I'm telling you, this was another excuse for the cops to murder one of us. And just like Minnesota, just like Minneapolis, the city itself, just like New York, Los Angeles, Ferguson, Dallas, just like all of these police departments all around the country, San Francisco, Detroit, Chicago, all of these police departments have a long history of assassinating black people. Assassinating brown people. Columbus has a long history of this. I'll get into that in a few minutes, but I want to talk about a 16-year-old girl who had the right to live. You heard that audio earlier. That was from M’khia Bryant's TikTok account. And if you watch that video, you will see a happy, wonderful, lovely child. She could be your daughter. She could be your sister. She could be your niece. She was a human being. And people in the United States have got to stop making excuses for murderers, killer cops. People have got to stop making excuses for killer cops. People have got to start opening their eyes and looking at us as black people and seeing our humanity and looking at us as the human beings that we are. And when a system and when a society stops doing that, it's over. And this system never looked at us as human beings. Never. Never has. And maybe never ever will. M’khia Bryant, as her mother explains, loving, kind, motherly nature about her, she says, promoted peace, which makes a lot of sense to me because she was defending herself from two girls who she thought were going to kill her or jump her or do something to her in her own home. And someone exercising self-defense in a state where there's something called the castle doctrine, meaning that you as someone in your own home has the right to use force to defend yourself in your own home. There is no duty to retreat. It's tantamount to stand your ground. I don't want to really confuse those things, lest I be in danger of doing so. But the castle doctrine is an old doctrine that goes back to English law, English common law, that says a man's home is his castle. And thus he should use all powers within his arsenal to protect his home and his person, and all of the persons within it. And all M’khia Bryant was doing was just that. That's all she was doing. And then the police come along and shoot her 4 times in the chest. That sounds like murder to me. What does it sound like to you? They took that girl's blackness. They took her humanity. That killer cop took her soul and decided that I'm just going to blast her. I don't care how close or how far away these girls were from each other. This is not the issue here. All of you on Twitter, those of you, and it's not you, dear listener, and it's not people listening to me, but these fools, they should ban stupidity on Twitter. They should ban stupidity on Twitter. All of these people out here rushing to make excuses for a killer cop. It's despicable, but it's also predictable. And all these bots and trolls who say they care so much about, oh, a black girl's life was in danger. She was going to get stabbed. Why don't you, since you care, Twitter troll, Twitter bot, so much about black girls, why don't you now donate your money to Paula Bryant and the other family members for M’khia Bryant or M’khia Bryant, and give that money to them so they can bury their 16-year-old. Donate money to M’khia Bryant's family now so they can pay the funeral costs to bury their baby, since you care so much about black girls. You don't give a damn about black girls. You don't give a damn about any of us. Give me that nonsense. You have white people armed to the gills. They don't get killed. They don't get shot. They don't get tasered. They get Burger King. Dylan Roof murdered 9 black people in a church in Charleston, South Carolina in 2015. He didn't get tasered. He didn't get shot at. He had a weapon on him. Didn't get killed. Didn't get tasered. He got Burger King. Police bought him Burger King. Oh, would you like, sir? I'll have the Whopper. 2, please. Is it? Can I have 2? Blood on his hands. I mean, right this way, sir. Here you are. Do you need some extra napkins with that? This is not a joke. That's what these killer cops do. That's what these police do. They defend their killer. White guy. Same thing with Ahmaud Arbery. One of those killers had ties and was a police investigator in that very same county. Only retired a few weeks or months before he participated in murdering a young man just jogging down the street in his neighborhood. And you've got one of those white killers on TV being interviewed by Chris Cuomo last year.
Oh, well, I don't really want to say anything.
Well, why the hell are you on the air?
Oh, but, you know, my client's not going to...
Why do you bring him on? Why did you come on the show? Oh, my client had nothing to do with this, and I don't... And within a week or two of that interview, he's arrested. William Ruddy, or whatever the hell his name was. William Ruddy. Why are you parading these killers on television? Giving them all kinds of airtime. Like they're some hero. Well, he videotaped it, but he didn't participate, and he didn't know that... This is a death culture. It's a system that promotes death, that is death. And this system is not working for the people who are getting killed in it. And that is us. It's working just fine for the killers and for those in control who are doing the oppressing of black people and brown people. But it ain't working for black and brown people. So the system's got to go. It's as simple as. And all of this ballyhooing. Oh, this is one giant step forward. President Biden, you really should be careful with saying things like, this is one giant step forward. It's one verdict, is what it is. It's not a giant step. It is one verdict. And we've got, right now that I can think of, at least half a dozen other cases like this that are out there right now. And what if all of those come back as not guilties or not indicted? How many steps forward is that for black people and justice? We live in a culture that is all about instant gratification, a system that rewards instant gratifications, and that's what it pushes. So that when one verdict comes along, there are people who jump up and down. And I'm telling you, I told you yesterday, dear listener, that I was happy that the verdict came down the way it did, but I was not celebrating. You still have a sentencing to deal with this guy, Derek Chauvin, this killer. And it's more relief than anything. I wasn't happy jumping up and down at all. It was a very, very sad day yesterday, despite the good news of guilty on all counts. Because as I said in yesterday's episode, at the end of the day, there is a 46-year-old man named George Perry Floyd Jr. who will never, ever come back to his family. His daughter will grow up without him. And so that's the thing that I was left with. That's what I was left with yesterday. Yes, the prosecution obviously did a good job in the end. Yes, the jury saw the humanity of George Perry Floyd. Yes, they did the right thing. Yes, it was a really important verdict. But let's not get carried away here. With all due respect to George Floyd's family, and I really do think that for them, this is a small, tiny piece of light. And that will certainly have probably made them sleep a tad bit easier. If I can even say that, that might be wholly arrogant and presumptuous of me. Because I bet they did a lot of crying last night too, if I may be so presumptuous. Do you know how hard it was to get that verdict? How much we all had to be in the streets around the world to get that verdict yesterday? All the activists locally in Minnesota that you never got to see on television around the country or the world, if you were in Minneapolis, you probably saw them locally on TV, and maybe even then, they didn't maybe perhaps shine the light on them as brightly or as often as they should have. The activists who stayed in the streets long after these national and international television cameras disappeared through rain, through sleet, through snow, and no one cared, they were out there. And it's them who are as responsible as that jury is, quite frankly, for getting us that verdict yesterday. And here's the kicker. We can't even have that moment of relief I couldn't even have that. And I'm not even a member of George Floyd's family. I'm not a member of the Bryant family, M’khia Bryant's family. I couldn't even, as a person, have a few minutes before hearing about what happened to M’khia Bryant. And all these fools are about, oh, she had a knife. Well, Kyle Rittenhouse had an assault rifle. Last August, in Kenosha, Wisconsin, Kyle Rittenhouse, white, 17 years old, he's 1 year older than M’khia Bryant was, with a AR-15 assault rifle slung over his shoulder across his chest, had just murdered two people, killed two people, walking with his rifle, which he's not supposed to have in the state of Wisconsin, especially when he crossed over state lines from Illinois. Walking down the street with his hands up, telling the police, look, I killed two people. I just killed two people. Arrest me. I just killed two people. The police was standing there in their tanks. They didn't say a thing to him. He was basically begging to be arrested. Police just let him go. He just kept walking. Police gave him water. They gave out bottled water to these murderers. These killers, these people with guns, gave him bottled water. The police giving these white boys bottled water to drink. Giving Dylan Roof Burger King to eat. That's what this system is. It's a system. It ain't just some police. It's a whole system that is anti-black, anti-brown, and pro-white dominance and killing. And that is what this system is. It's been working just fine for those who created it, for those who do it, and for those doing the oppression. Kyle Rittenhouse gets to walk out of the state. They basically rolled out the red carpet. Thank you very much, sir. You all come back now, you hear? Walked back into Illinois, untouched. And it took weeks, if not months, before he was even extradited. I don't know if he even was. And then millions of dollars, $1 million+ was raised for him. Police chiefs, sergeants, certainly police sergeants, politicians, donating money to a murderer. He wasn't doing anything in self-defense. He was there to kill people. What are you doing with an AR-15 defending a boarded up business at night? What do you think that's about, folks? I posed that question months ago when this happened back in August on an episode of this podcast. I asked, what on earth are people doing in a neighborhood at night, supposedly standing outside a business, supposedly defending it, when the business was boarded up? We're here to protect these boarded up businesses. They're boarded up. What is there to protect? And what are you doing at night? Why are you there at night protecting them? And they're already boarded up, and you've got an AR-15 strapped across your chest. Why weren't you there during the day then? Why did you have to be there at night? Because you know that shit goes down at night. So you decided to go there at night. You weren't there interested in protecting a damn business. Did you consult with the people whose business that it is? Do you know whose business it was or whose businesses those were that you stood in front of that were already boarded up? Did you know? So what the hell are you there for then? You were there to kill people. You were there to kill. And this is the death culture. This is the death system. The system of death. That is protected, created, and promoted by the rich and the powerful. and the whitest of white. It's an anti-blackness system. And Kyle Rittenhouse killed two white people. He was allowed to walk away. Because the issue is that as long as a white male does these things, he is protected. As long as a white female does these things, as we've seen in these situations with white female police officers, they are protected too. I just keep thinking of the murder in Oklahoma of Terrence Crutcher. And someone said yesterday he was running away from the police. He wasn't running from the police. He walked away from the police. He was told to walk, if I'm not mistaken, by the cop who murdered him. And as he walked away with his hands on his head, she shot him dead in the back of the head. Executed him. That's an execution. She didn't get any kind of indictment or prison time or anything. Betty or Betsy or whatever. And she's got another job at some police place somewhere. Or some, what is it, motivational speaking place or whatever the hell she's part of. That's the system of death. That's a death system. That's a death culture. Murdering one of us and you get to do this and that and the other. And go about your day. Murdering Tamir Rice. 12, 13, 12 years old. Had everything to live for. Doesn't matter what his circumstances were. You cannot get away with this. But they're getting away with it. They've been getting away with it for 400 plus years. That cop who murdered him on sight. Within 0.1, whatever, 1.1 seconds. That cop, who had already had previous incidents, gets to have another job at another precinct two towns over within the next 6 months to a year. He's never indicted. He was never indicted for murdering Tamir Rice. Oh, Tamir Rice had a toy gun. Ooh, a 12-year-old with a toy gun. Oh, let's eradicate him from the face of the earth. Oh, isn't that marvelous? 12-year-old black boy with a toy gun. And John Crawford III, who is what, 20-something, with a gun inside a Walmart. Both of them end up getting killed. Kyle Rittenhouse with an AR-15, who's killed two people, he gets to go walk home.
You're free to leave the state, sir.
Dylan Roof, he kills nine people in a church. He gets Burger King. Isn't that special? He doesn't get tased. He doesn't get a cop mistaking a gun for a taser. He doesn't get that. There's no cop pulling out a taser and accidentally pulling out a gun instead. There's no cop pulling out a gun thinking it's a taser. It's not happening in Dylan Roof's case. In Kyle Rittenhouse's case, Kyle Rittenhouse told them he murdered two people. Told them he killed two people. He gets to walk free. And he gets millions of dollars raised for him. And he gets police sergeants raising money for him and donating money to him. All these Twitter trolls, if you are really interested in caring, you show you care about black girls, then donate some money to the family of M’khia Bryant. Donate some money to her family to help them pay the funeral costs that they will have to pay to bury their 16-year-old. That's what I would like those Twitter trolls to do. and these bots and these people. Get out there, dig into your pockets, donate some money to that family. Donate that money to Paula Bryant. You see, in the end of the day, it doesn't matter that M’khia Bryant was an honor student. And this society always does this, right? And I know her mother speaking lovingly about her. But we always in this society, especially here in the United States, we start to credential the dead. Right? We get into this thing. And it's not, I'm not even talking about Paula Bryant as the mother. I'm talking in general. Particularly when it comes to black people being murdered by these cops out here or by anybody else in the system or by these white mobs. We get into what I call credentialing the dead. Oh, well, he was an honor student. She was an honor student. Oh, my goodness. And this and that and the other. And I'm saying to you, and again, this is not addressed to Paula Bryant. I'm saying to the society, it doesn't matter what any of these people who were shot dead by police were. I don't care if they had criminal records. I don't care what they've done. I don't care if they were on the honor roll, were not on the honor roll. They were human beings. And you've got to see our humanity. Not our grade point average, not which school we went to or which school we didn't go to. Not whether we're lawyers or doctors or rappers or artists or scientists or anything. That is not the standard by which you have empathy for someone whose life is taken or their family who loses that person. That's not the standard. You know what the standard is? It's a human being. That's the standard. It's having an ounce of compassion for human beings. And as I said with the jury in the Chauvin trial, the test, and this extends to everyday people, certainly everyday white people. Do you see our humanity? Do you choose to want to see a black person's humanity? If you choose to want to see that and you see it, then it doesn't matter what kinds of things M’khia Bryant did or did not do. It doesn't matter whether she had black joy or whether she didn't. It doesn't matter whether she was an honor student or whether she wasn't. What matters was that she should still be here. She was a human being. And that is the founding fundamental principle that you or anyone else out here should operate by. You have to start having some empathy and compassion. If your heart is so hardened and so closed and so empty and barren of any notion of feeling or empathy or anything. If you've got nothing like that at all registering in your system, you're done for. You're long gone. There's no hope for you. And this society engages in this credentialing of the dead. As if we as black people have to convince the larger white society that she is worthy of your sympathy because she was an honor student. And again, I'm not directing this to Paula Bryant. I'm sure the reporter asked her, well, what do you tell me about M’khia? And that's probably when you heard what you heard in that audio I played earlier. They never give you the question, right? They always give you the clip of the response to the question that is asked. But this is really the situation. People are credentialing the dead. And this is not what we should be doing. This should always be on the operative level of humanity was taken and taken violently, and that this killer cop had no right to do that. I know the system gave that cop the right to do it, but I am saying that if there was real accountability and justice, these shootings wouldn't continue to happen. And if there wasn't an anti-black system and a system of institutionalized racism and anti-black violence, you wouldn't have this. You wouldn't have these shootings. And that's why that piece of audio, that 13 minutes or so that I played in yesterday's episode of Keith Ellison, the Minnesota Attorney General, is so important, because he talked about this not being justice in terms of Derek Chauvin being found guilty. He talked about it being accountability. Is that this jury yesterday held Derek Chauvin, the killer cop, accountable for his violence. But it is not really justice. It's a step in the wheel of justice, or a step towards justice. And I think Keith Ellison is correct. That's why I played that whole 12 or 13 minutes. It's really important. That was please go back to Tuesday's episode, April 20th, 2021. Please listen to that. And please listen particularly to Keith Ellison, because he said a lot of important things. One of them was that this was not really justice. It was accountability. And that's true. And I said even yesterday, well, yeah, it's a modicum of justice. It's some justice. But really, if you listen to Keith Ellison, I have to be inclined to correct myself and say it's accountability. And I think I did mention that yesterday. It is accountability. But if Derek Chauvin, in June of 2021, is sentenced to next to nothing, that is not justice. And it certainly isn't accountability. It's certainly not reflected in any low sentence that he may get. And that possibility is still there, that he may not get sentenced to much of anything. How many times have we seen this? Amber Geiger, just a couple of years ago, a year or two ago, murdered Botham Jean, and a year or two ago, Botham Jean in his own apartment, she murdered him, white female cop in Dallas, Texas. And what did she get? 10 years? 10 years was what she got. And I'm telling you, she's going to get out before she serves 5 years. Once they look at good behavior, she'll be out in less than 5 years. I'm telling you. I'm telling you. So President Biden and some of these other folks, some of them black folk, jumping up and down out here, and some white folk jumping up and down, some of them jumping up and down out here, talking about this is a new day and this is a substantial step forward toward justice and this is a big deal. It's an important day. I won't dismiss it. Yesterday was an important day. But I, again, want to remind people who are already in cloud happy land over yesterday, two things. Look at how much it took to get this verdict. Look at all the things that had to happen to get to that verdict. Look at all the things we had to do to get to this verdict. Look at all the people who had to be in the streets every day, every night when no one was looking, when it was cold, when it was dark, when it was raining, when it was snowing in Minneapolis, and you didn't see the TV pictures, when the marching globally stopped. Those activists out there on the streets of Minneapolis, God bless them. You know, they don't get half the credit. And all the higher profile figures come in and they do this and they do that. I'm not saying they don't do much, but they come in and take all the and the cameras are there. It's not necessarily really their fault. The cameras gravitate to the most high profile. That's all a thing called ratings. So it's not their fault. But what happens is the activists in the community who know the community, who've been there forever, who grew up there, they don't get the credit, and they should. I'm not turning this into, well, they're getting robbed of credit. I'm saying they should be acknowledged. And I'm glad that Ben Crump did that yesterday, because that should happen. But look at what it took to those of you out there who are in cloud happy land, happy clappy land, about this verdict yesterday. Like I say, it's not really that I'm happy. I'm not. I'm happy in the sense that this verdict came down, but am I happy? No. Because George Floyd should still be here. Am I happy? No. Because even though this family has a modicum of something in this verdict to hold on to, this fight's far from over. They still don't have their son. It's not going to bring him back, obviously. And we've got M’khia Bryant, 16 years old, dead. Dante Wright, 20 years old, dead. Adam Toledo, 13 years old, dead. Breonna Taylor, 26 years old, dead. Rayshard Brooks, dead. People have forgotten Rayshard Brooks. Running away with a taser, and the police shoot him in the back 2 or 3 times, killing him. One of the cops stands on one of his arms, stands on one of his shoulders while he lays dying. That's what the police do to us. These 2 white male cops. Kyle Rittenhouse gets to walk out of the state of Wisconsin, though, with his AR-15. Walking away from the police. He's walking away from the police with his AR-15. Police don't shoot after him. They don't shoot him. He's walking away with an AR-15, having killed 2 people, having admitted to the police without being prompted to that he killed 2 people. They don't taser him. They don't shoot him in the back. I'm not asking them to, but I am simply making a point here. You've got a death system that works in favor of white male killers and of white people overall. And when a black person dares to defend themselves and makes what they think is a genuine call for some intervention from a state entity that is supposed to protect them, and they try to defend their lives in accordance with the castle doctrine, protecting the home, defend the home, they get murdered by the police that they call. Marissa Alexander fires a warning shot in Florida against her abusive husband. She gets sentenced to 20 years in prison. And if it's not for zealous advocacy and people standing for her and doing the legal work and fighting for her and advocating for her, the black woman, Marissa Alexander, would still be in prison. Firing a warning shot into the air because of her violent, abusive husband. using the very same stand your ground doctrine, castle doctrine. In Florida, stand your ground. Oh, but when a black woman uses stand your ground, a warning shot against an abusive husband? Oh, she's got to go to prison for 20 years. Oh, we've got to imprison her. This is what I'm talking about. This is the death system that punishes black people for living and aids and abets white people for killing. Welcome back. M’khia Bryant, and I may alternate between the pronunciation of her name. I'm sorry. That could be your daughter. That could be your friend. That could be your niece. That could be your sister. And even if that wasn't or couldn't be your sister or niece, she's a human being. She's a human being. And I am saying to these people, wherever they are, I don't care where they are, whether they're on social media or whether they are walking and talking here on these streets, because M’khia Bryant isn't walking and talking anymore. She's dead. Some killer cop murdered her. If you shoot someone 4 times in her chest, that is murder. And not only that, you are recklessly endangering the lives of the people around her. And I'm telling you, if this ever sees any kind of day in court, which I'll be shocked if it does, it's going to be like the situation in Rayshard Brooks' case, that murder. Because that cop that murdered Rayshard Brooks, who shot him in the back at least twice, if not 3 times, was shooting into a Wendy's parking lot when there were at least 7 or 8 other cars in that parking lot with human beings in them waiting for their turn in the drive-thru. And a few of those bullets actually struck vehicles with human beings in them. A kid was in one of them with his father. And the bullet was literally a few inches from him. It nearly killed him. This cop didn't know what the hell are you doing? And then that killer cop kills Rayshard Brooks. This killer cop, well, we don't know his name yet. Ooh, his name is not being released. Is he still getting paid? Is he getting his pension? What's he up to? Are they going to construct a 48-hour story for him like they do with cops? I don't care how the New York Times writes these stories. Oh, she lunged at someone. Again, trying to criminalize and characterize a black person's movements. And not talk about the fact that she called the police because she was afraid for her life. And then called the police who ended up taking her life. And the Columbus police think they're slick. They must think they're like Bill Barr. They must totally think that they are like the former attorney general, the former twice attorney general, Bill Barr. Oh, I'm going to release piecemeal. Oh, the Mueller report. I'm going to give you my 4-paragraph summary of that report. I'm going to take things out of context and I'm going to prejudice you with my assessment and leave it out there permeating in the public mind, in your brain, for days and weeks before the actual report comes out in full. So that in 3 or 4 weeks' time, when the actual report comes out, oh, It's not going to matter to you, you see, because my four-paragraph summary is going to be all that sticks in your mind for those 3 weeks or 4 weeks or 2 weeks or however long it was. It's about three and a half weeks, a month before we found out, oh, Mueller report. And who reads, right? Okay, there are many millions of us who read in the United States, but you know what I'm talking about. The average everyday person, quite frankly, doesn't have time to read, much less alone doesn't read at all. But Twitter headlines and blurbs and tweets. But who read that Mueller report? I didn't read all, 200, 400 pages of it, whatever it was, 400 pages of it. I didn't read all 400 pages of that report. I read maybe about 25. Who read the full Mueller report? Who's listening to me right now? I know she's not listening to me right now, most likely, but Senator Elizabeth Warren read every page of it. She's one of the only people who has. She's, I think, the only person in the whole of Congress, House, or Senate who has. And that report read very differently from the four-page summary that Bill Barr put forth. And so I mentioned Bill Barr because the Columbus police yesterday released body camera footage and only a portion of it. And then they said, oh, well, today, Wednesday, we'll release the rest. So you released a portion of it on Tuesday night, April 20th, 2021. And then say, well, I'm going to release all of it tomorrow. So why didn't you release all of it last night? Because you wanted to, I think, permeate the public mind so they get to see the image of M’khia Bryant with a knife lunging at another girl. And with no context, by the way. No one's saying anything about the fact that she called the police because this particular girl and maybe another girl that she was supposedly, that she was lunging at, had been trying to jump her. She was worried about that. How come no one cares about that aspect of the story? Or few do, right? But when a police officer says, oh, I thought, he had a war, he had a gun, or it was a wallet, I picked out my taser, but no, it was a gun. How come everybody or people are sympathetic to that? How come so many jurors are? But when a black girl's defending herself and defending her life, all of you out here, whoever you are, if the shoe fits, are all about, well, she had a knife, well, she lunged, well, and her ass is killed dead. How is that going on if you say you care about humanity? Why are you so quick to attack and assail a 16-year-old baby? But you then defend baby-faced killers and murderers and cops who are twice M’khia Bryant's age, who murder black people and brown people. Riddle me that. Riddle me that. ...16-year-old girl, obviously terrified for her life. She's defending her home. What about that don't those racists out there understand? They understand it very clearly. Their whole ethos is black people don't deserve to live and they don't deserve to defend themselves. And that the castle doctrine doesn't apply to them. That's what these racist people are thinking. That's what they're feeling. That's what they're saying. And that is the truth. Marissa Alexander, she doesn't deserve to protect herself from an abusive and violent husband. Oh no, the black woman can't do that. She can't fire a warning shot into the garage or into the ceiling of her garage in Florida. She can't use stand your ground. But George Zimmerman can use that in a trial when he murdered Trayvon Martin in the same damn state and he gets to walk free. Oh yeah, this system is not a death, it's not a death system, is it? Oh, of course not. So the black 16 or 17-year-old named Trayvon Martin is murdered and George Zimmerman gets to walk free asserting stand your ground when he was the one that was hounding and following Trayvon Martin in Sanford, Florida, when the police, of all people, had told him to not follow Trayvon Martin, to leave him alone. We'll take care of him. So I guess George Zimmerman was doing what the police would have done. This wannabe cop, George Zimmerman, felt the need to just deputize himself and then turn around in a courtroom, which is going to be favorable to him because it's part of the same death system that oppresses black people and brown people. Turn around and say, oh, stand your ground. I feared for my life. Stand your ground. Stand your ground. He's not in his home. But that's the law. When you've got Alec and all these other Republican bodies and these money-grubbing scumbags writing the laws about gun safety, about guns, not even gun safety, these people want more guns on the streets. And the gun manufacturers' stock prices go through the roof. They make lots of money. Congresspersons in the United States get money in their pockets from Alec and all these other places. Lobbyists write these blooming laws. And black people get killed and die. And then you've got mass shootings where white people are getting killed in those. Black people are getting killed in those. El Paso, Texas, brown people being murdered. And you notice how sick these folks are? These murderers, how evil they are? They go drive hundreds and hundreds of miles across state. Patrick Crucius, that piece of garbage that the police, the white guy, that the police basically said, I see you've got a gun and an assault rifle in here. You're under arrest, sir. He's just sitting there with his guns there. The police don't blast him. They just come up to him and politely arrest him. No, okay. Never mind the fact there's, what, 26 people dead that he killed in El Paso in, what, 2019, I think it was? 2019. Goes into a Walmart, goes into a supermarket area, and literally murders all of these people. All of these brown people, minding their business. Human beings. And the police barely touch him. Okay, you're arrested. Same thing in Boulder, Colorado. Arrested without incident. Guy's got blood all over his leg and all this shit. And handcuffs him. They don't do anything like they did to George Floyd. To him, he's just killed 10 people. 10 people. White guy gets the VIP treatment for murdering 10 people. Dylan Roof gets the VIP treatment for murdering 8 people. 9 people he murdered. 9 people. Burger King for you, sir. It's too bad you couldn't have made it a perfect 10. We would have got you a lifetime supply of Burger King if you had managed to make it 10 people that you killed. This is the mentality. I know it didn't happen like that, and the police may not have said that to Dylan Roof, but that's the mentality of the society That's the mentality of the system that's working so well for all of those who killing it, the white ones who killing it, and the people who set this system up. Columbus PD has had a long history, and I said I'd get to this a little bit later than advertised, but better late than never, I guess. They've had a long history, as I told you. Surprise, surprise. All of these police departments do. A long history of this, right? So, Columbus PD this is just let me read this first before I get to Columbus PD and its history. This is long gone. I'm just going to read you like the last few, well, whatever. I'll get to it in a moment, I promise. Rayshawn Whiting said in an interview, this is from the New York Times story, on Tuesday night, that he was at his brother's house just a few blocks away from where the shooting took place to watch the Chauvin verdict when he heard gunshots. When he saw on social media what was going on, he walked down the street to join the throng of protesters who reached between 150 and 200 people at their peak. Quote, I've got daughters, he said. Quote, and I'm tired of it. I feel like a polar bear with the ice caps melting. We have nowhere to run. If we protect ourselves, we go to jail. If we don't, we die. Well, M’khia Bryant protected herself and she died. No mention of the Castle Doctrine. Ohio has the Castle Doctrine, which allows someone in their home, in front of their home, to protect themselves and defend themselves and use force when necessary to protect and preserve their lives and the lives of others in and around them, in their home. Defend the home. But all of a sudden, that doesn't apply to black people. Black Panthers in 1966 or 67 or 65, whenever it was, on the steps of the Sacramento Capitol building, the state Capitol building in California, open carry state at the time. Black Panthers with rifles show up there. Ronald Reagan, the governor at the time, basically the very next hour, he outlaws open carry altogether. He really wanted to outlaw it only for black people, but, in a time where the Civil Rights Bill had just been passed or recently been passed in the country, that would not have gone down very well. Not a good look. So I'm going to ban open carry. But it was really intended for, meaning black people shouldn't carry guns. But white people now, all over this country and a lot of these states, open carry. Black person engaging in open carry, they get killed. They get pulled over. They get tased. White people with their guns, open carry, no problem. They can go into state legislatures like Michigan. No longer. They finally banned that after what happened in the terror attack on January 6th. But, they can get to walk around with their guns, these white folk. They can walk around with their gun, their AR-15 Kyle Rittenhouse. And the police can just let them go, even when they admit to the police. They just kill two people. Oh, no, it's okay. They go. That's your death system. That's your system that protects white people who murder and kill. Now, police let them go. He's not allowed to carry a weapon across state lines. It's illegal to do that. Certainly from Illinois into Wisconsin. And Wisconsin law says that it's illegal. But no stopping Carl Rittenhouse. He then gets money. They raise money for him like they did for George Zimmerman. Oh, yes, and you'll be congratulated by the police. Well done, boy. Good job. You just murdered another black person. You murdered two white people. Good job. And it's just insane evil. Why is it that when, and in the majority of these cases, Kyle Rittenhouse is really, in terms of the fact that he killed two white people and shot the arm off another, may I add, is the exception in terms of the fact that he murdered white people. But in any event, it's a white male doing it. If it was a black person that murdered two white people, do you think the police would have let him walk out of there with an AR-15 and tell him, "Thank you very much, black boy. You're free to go." You think that would have happened? Do you think that would have happened? People have to start not only waking up, but they've got to start doing and saying things. You cannot turn yourself off from this. Some silly, silly cab driver says to me yesterday, Asian man says to me, Asian cab driver, "Oh, I'm so upset. I didn't make any money today. All these protests downtown in San Francisco, they've closed everything off. All these protests." And I'm wearing my Black Lives Matter t-shirt. So he thinks that he can try to start something. He thinks I'm going to now get into it with him, which is what he wants. "Oh, they've closed. Oh, the protests." I said to him, "Aren't there other places in San Francisco where you can drive to and make your money?" "Yes." "So what are you talking about?" "Stay away from downtown. San Francisco isn't just downtown. It's a population of over 900,000 people. 49 square miles. Yes, it's small, but downtown does not encompass the entirety of the city of San Francisco. You have plenty of other places to get fares as a taxi driver." And then I said to him, "You're complaining about one day? The whole last 12 to 15 months has been terrible for cab drivers. Your industry sucks. You've got no business. You're not getting any business because no one's jumping into your cabs during a pandemic. So, of course, the ridership in your taxi has gone down throughout the whole last 15 months, and you're focusing on one day?" That's what I said to him. "You're focusing on one day." But what you really, and I didn't say this part to him, but what he was really doing was trying to start some garbage with me. And who does that? Who does something like that? Where you should just be either focusing on your job or saying, "Oh, I'm really, you know, it's great that this person was convicted. Oh, I didn't get business down and downtown's boarded up," or "downtown's..." Well, why is it boarded up? Why is it being blocked off? "I didn't get any business down downtown." Like downtown's your whole reason for living. Oh, shut up, you know? But that, again, that was done and deliberately done to try to start something. So he wanted me to get back at him and start arguing. I didn't take that bait. I'm not stupid. I wonder if he would have complained just a few short weeks ago about all the protests in and around this city when Asian people, and they're still being murdered in San Francisco and being attacked. I wonder if he, as an Asian cab driver, had any issue about, "Oh, I can't get fares in downtown because there are these Stop AAPI hate protests going on. Ooh, I can't get a fare. I can't get any fares." I wonder if he has said that to an Asian person who had the t-shirt Stop AAPI Hate on, who had, or just didn't have a t-shirt on, just had other clothing on. I wonder if he would have said that to them. But to the black guy who has the Black Lives Matter shirt on, or even if I didn't have it on, I had some other item of clothing on instead of that, he's got to say, "Ooh, I didn't get fares." So what? I don't give a rat's ass. You got my fare. I'm in the back of your vehicle. So you got my fare. It's like, it's just bizarre. I mean, this is the kind of system you're in and the kind of indifference and callousness that you get. And yeah, it's not just from white people. It's from some Asians and some others. Yeah, I mean, this is no appreciation or care about humanity at all. It's their selfishness and their money. And didn't even, you know, notice, oh, by the way, you do have a black person in this cab that's patronizing you right now, right? And you're now complaining to me about the fares that you didn't get, and you've got a fare sitting in your car? You cannot script this. Hollywood would have thrown this script in the garbage. We're going to keep standing up against this violence and injustice, and we're going to keep advocating for justice. And to think that Judge Bruce Cahill, who looked very miserable yesterday before he read out that verdict, and I knew right there that, by the way, that Derek Chauvin was going down, because you could just look on the face of Judge Bruce Cahill, who I thought, as I said, I gave him a 6 to 6.5 out of 10. And probably now wish I had revised that downward, although it's never too late, right? But he didn't look very happy. Not that he should be gleeful. I'm not saying that a judge should. A judge is supposed to be impartial. Supposed to be. But he did not run that Derek Chauvin murder trial in any impartial way, in my view. Gave the defense a lot of avenues for an appeal, which is why I say, do not celebrate and jump up and down. You know, because this is fleeting. Every exception can be turned around very quickly. And keep your eye on this. And we need to keep the pressure up and on. We need to. Because people now, I think, are thinking, oh, great. Oh, happy day. Edwin Walker, I guess, and then the choir. I forget the name of the exact. Oh, happy day. And it's not oh, happy day at all. It's not. It's not. You know, it's just not. I mean, Bruce Cahill, the judge, was not happy. You could tell. He read it. He's kind of sighing and he looks and he reads the verdict out really curtly. And this was a heavy duty jury service. All right, that's it. You judge just jury dismissed. Oh, this guy clear. You know, he wasn't happy with that verdict. He wasn't. He wasn't. Tell you, go watch that video of him reading out that verdict. He's disappointed. That's what I think. And then the nerve of him. See, this is where he tipped his hand. And I didn't really talk about this appreciably yesterday in the midst of reacting and processing all of the this verdict and the feelings, the mixed feelings, because it really was a day where I wasn't jumping up and down happy. I don't know if you were, dear listener, but I certainly wasn't. I'll tell you straight up. This was not a day to be celebrating anything. Doesn't matter what you saw on your TVs. The fact is that a family will never get back this member of their family. And again, look at what it took for this moment to even come. And not only that, it can be undone in the sentencing. That's why I say keep the pressure on. Keep this case going. Because in June, when Derek Chauvin, the killer cop, he's no longer a cop, but he's still a killer cop, okay? When he gets sentenced, if he turns, if the judge, I don't know if it's going to be Judge Cahill or not, probably will be, I don't know. Or it may be just a different judge, and I hope it is. If that judge turns around, whomever that judge is, and turns around and sentences Derek Chauvin to 5 years, 10 years, or only 12 years, which is what you're hearing, and not the 40 years that those counts as maximum would get him, it's a travesty. But it's in line with what the system does. So you've got to keep the pressure on. That's one. Number two, Bruce Cahill has created a whole record of appealable error where it can be appealed, where that defense, Eric Nelson, can absolutely appeal. And it's got nothing to do with Congresswoman Waters. And that's when I knew that Judge Cahill showed his true colors on Monday of this week when he was complaining, oh, Congresswoman Waters. And by the way, Eric Nelson never even mentioned the Congresswoman's name. He just said there are members of Congress who are making statements about threatening confrontation and violence. And that was just a complete lie because Congresswoman Waters said nothing about violence. But again, when some white people hear black people talk, and when they hear the word confrontation, a lot of those white people who hear that think, oh, they mean violence. Because that's what the white person means when they say it. So they impute that somehow to black folk. And they impute it also due to their own racist tendencies. So they project their racist tendencies onto black people and say, well, that, oh, she's talking about violence. Now, why would a Congresswoman named Maxine Waters do that when you've got Republican congresspeople who do that? When you've got Rudy Giuliani who says trial by combat? When you've got Donald Trump who says you've got to fight like hell to an amped up crowd who committed a terrorist attack at his direction on January 6, 2021? Why is Congresswoman Maxine Waters going to do that? I don't think so, Judge Cahill. I don't think so. So why did you mention her name in the first place? Showing your true colors, aren't you? Oh, she shouldn't make these statements. She's not a juror. She's not a member of the jury. Oh, she shouldn't make these statements. And he got angrier. She shouldn't make these statements. They should be recognizing the separation of the powers and the branches of co-equal. What? And that tells me exactly where Judge Bruce Cahill is. And he didn't do nearly enough to place the restrictions on persons and people in general that he should have in his courtroom. Because I think he knew this case was going to go against Derek Chauvin and he wanted to give the defense a chance on appeal. Letting a woman, or woman, man, whomever, but it was a woman in this case, letting a woman, a black woman, take pictures inside the courtroom. Like that was, maybe that was a setup. Who the hell knows, right? I don't know. How are you going to let someone take the pictures inside a courthouse, inside the courtroom, with such a high profile case? How are you going to do that? And call yourself a judge, and call yourself a judge who's serious about impartiality and having a good, well, the word good is misplaced here, having a trial run properly. I told you from the jump when I saw that on day number one or two or whenever it was of this trial, I really shook my head at this judge and the way things were going. And that's why I say some of you out here, whoever you are, if it applies to you, the shoe fits you, you know what to do with it. Celebrating and jumping up and down, really? To those of the people in the world, to those of the people in the world who are doing that or who did that, stop jumping. Stop jumping. Because this is not over yet. You still have a sentencing to go through. And remember Amber Geiger, the white female cop who murdered Bofam Jean in his own apartment. Charlena Lyles, murdered in her own apartment. Pregnant woman, black woman. A Tatiana Jefferson, murdered in her apartment. Black woman. Breonna Taylor, murdered in her apartment. Black woman. All of these murders by police. And now, M’khia Bryant, murdered in front of her home, defending herself. In self-defense, murdered by police. Bruce Springsteen, American Skin, 41 shots. That was written about Amadou Diallo. That's one name, that's one person I didn't mention in that last portion there when I talked about just a few of the black people who have been murdered by police in their own homes or just outside their own home by cops. I mean, it's just Amadou Diallo, 1999. In the Bronx, New York, right in front of his apartment building. He's trying to get into his apartment building, get into his home, and the cops blast him, shoot him 41 times, 41 shots. That's what that song was about, Bruce Springsteen. NYPD blew him away. Oh, it was a wallet. Oops. That's the mentality of the culture, of the system. And I believe the proceeds of that song went to Diallo, the Diallo Foundation and Diallo's family. And I remember when he sang that. And the police, the NYPD, didn't want anything to do with Bruce Springsteen. We're going to boycott his concerts. And he... Oh, please. Pat Lynch, the PBA, Patrolman's Benevolent. I don't know what's benevolent about these murderers. Benevolent Association. Pat Lynch, he's still the president of that in New York, if I'm not mistaken. Oh, we're going to lead a boy, we do Bruce Springsteen, how dare he, and these cops, and they would boo Bruce Springsteen when he sang that song at his concerts. Give me a break. That's evil. That is evil. You're booing someone, an artist who has the consciousness and the compassion to write a song like that. You love Bruce Springsteen, but when he speaks about something or sings about something that is about social justice and consciousness and the atrocities of a system that is running very well, thank you very much, for those in power and for those who are white and for those who are murderers who are white, then you now have a problem with Bruce Springsteen. And you choose to ignore the reality around you. How cold and barren and empty and sick and evil are you? For you to do something like that, that level of cognitive disengagement, you've deliberately chosen to close your eyes and close your heart and close your mind. In service of what exactly? That's for you to sort out, not for me to psychoanalyze. All right, here it is, the Columbus PD. Now, this is Columbus, Ohio, and let me just tell you this, right? Because we would like to think, or some people would like to think, that this is all some kind of game. It ain't a game. This is what's happening out here. You know, this is what's happening. And I think it's about time people start to pay attention to the reality and not to the fantasy that they keep lying to themselves about. You had in Columbus, Ohio, because again, so that people can really understand that this is something that is not just something that happened yesterday to M’khia Bryant, but has been going on and happening to black people forever in Columbus, as with across the entire US of A. You have this whole thing, right, in Columbus, Ohio. So before M’khia Bryant was murdered, and yes, she was murdered. I don't want to hear about, well, you don't know that. Murder's a legal term. Murder's fine. I'm an attorney, and listen, I get it. But listen, man, come on now. Don't piss on us and tell us it's raining out here. The only thing raining is bullets. And they're raining on black bodies and brown bodies and black people and brown people. Do not think that we're stupid out here, because we are not. This is something that's been going on forever in Columbus. Just in December of 2020, Casey Goodson Jr., 23 years old, was shot to death at the entrance of his home by a Franklin County Sheriff's deputy assigned to a fugitive task force. Members of the... This is in Columbus, Ohio. Just December, just 4 months ago. Members of the task force had been in the area looking for someone in an operation that had nothing to do with Mr. Goodson. So Casey Goodson Jr., 23, was shot to death by the police. It had nothing to do with the person you shot to death, however. Oh, any old black person will do. Same article I'm reading from. This is from the New York Times. Teenage girl is fatally shot by police in Columbus, officials say. That was the article. 2 weeks later, and by the way, I need to put that in the newsletter. The newsletter has been taking a day or two off here, if you will. There's just so much going on out here. And, you know, anyway, the newsletter will revive itself for this episode. It will compile some of the things that have been going on and some of the extras that you should be aware of. But let me continue here. 2 weeks later, same article, 2 weeks later, Andre Hill, 47, was shot four times by a Columbus police officer who was responding to a call about a suspicious vehicle. When officers arrived to investigate, they encountered Mr. Hill and one of the officers, Adam Coy, a 19-year veteran, opened fire within seconds. Let me read that again. When officers arrived to investigate, listen to the way this is written. Because I do scrutinize the way these stories are written. When officers arrived to investigate, they encountered Mr. Hill and one of the officers, Adam Coy, a 19-year veteran, opened fire within seconds. Mr. Coy, who was fired after the shooting, was charged with felony murder in the case. So wait a minute. That's two shootings in the space of barely 3 weeks. 2 weeks later, two shootings in just 2 weeks. Of black people, two killings of black people by cops in Columbus, 2 weeks apart. Four times. That sounds like an execution to me, mate. Whether it's once, twice, three bullets, four times, whatever, that's an execution. Same thing with M’khia Bryant. M’khia Bryant shot four times in the chest. You got white people swinging axes at cops. Swinging axes at them. An axe. Swords. They never get shot. They barely get tasered. That's three dead black people in the space of 5 months, 4 months. And those are the ones just we know of. In Columbus alone. At the hands of cops. That's the system working perfectly from the system's point of view, but it ain't working for us as black folk. It ain't working for brown folk like Adam Toledo. It's working just fine for Kyle Rittenhouse, though, isn't it? Dylann Roof, I mean, yeah, I know he's on death row or he's been fried already or whatever. I don't believe in the death penalty. I think Dylann Roof should spend the rest of his life behind bars. So should Derek Chauvin, Carl Rittenhouse, all of these other killer cops out here. Rittenhouse is not a cop. He wanted to be a cop. He was at Trump rallies. He was this wannabe cop. Just like George Zimmerman. This mentality that this culture has. Ooh, the police are the best thing since sliced bread. And glamorizing them in TV shows and movies. I did a whole episode on this last year about that. Or it may have been this year. I think it was last year. You can go and search that. About how that can, and cops, bad boys. What you gonna, I'm not talking about the movie. I'm talking about the TV show. Ratings through the roof on Fox. And then they canceled that show. And then they canceled these other ones. And then you got white hosts. Oh, they're so upset that my show is being canceled. Police 911 or whatever that show was. Not the Brooklyn 999. That, no, I'm not talking about the comedy. I'm talking about that show that Dan Abrams did. Oh, and he was so upset they canceled it. And ooh. They're not canceling murdering police. They're not canceling murdering black people. That ain't being canceled out here. I'll tell you that right now. They're not canceling murdering brown people. That's not being canceled. Oh, but be calm. The community should be calm. Be calm, be calm. We'll just keep murdering you. Be calm, be calm. They're there. Oh, that feels good. They're there. Now we're just going to pump a couple more bullets into you. So that article, that portion of it. So wait, Andre Hill was shot 4 times, right? Cop responding to a call about a suspicious vehicle. Okay, so what about that vehicle? What was suspicious about it? We're not told. Officers arrived to investigate. They encountered Mr. Hill. Okay, what was Mr. Hill doing or not doing? Nothing, because if he was doing something, you would have sure as hell written it into that article. And one of the cops blasts him away within seconds. Okay, so now you've murdered him. But now the New York Times writes it as if there was something inherently dangerous about Andre Hill. How can you not supply detail there? But then put in, oh, he's a 19-year veteran, this cop. So that means he must know what he's doing here. Opening fire within seconds. Well, why did he blast him away like that? Why did he blast him at all? Just bizarre. Well, it's not bizarre because we know that, listen, this is an execution. Emmett Till was an execution. George Floyd was an execution. Tatiana Jefferson, an execution. Philando Castile, an execution. Alton Sterling, an execution. Terrence Crutcher, an execution. Michael Brown, an execution. Eric Garner, an execution. Breonna Taylor, an execution. This goes on and on. This is continuous. It's not about history repeating or not repeating. This is continuous. The Columbus police have been doing this forever. Casey Goodson shot to death at the entrance of his own home, and the operation had nothing to do with him. Breonna Taylor shot to death in her bed. In her own home? Oh, whoa, we were supposed to serve the person we were looking for, he's already in jail. He's already in custody. So what the hell were you doing? And they only make these kinds of quote-unquote mistakes when it comes to us as black people. That's the only, my goodness, taser, taser, taser. Bang, and you kill him. You kill a 20-year-old Dante Wright. You shout, gun, 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 and then that gives you the license to go murder someone, black or brown. When there is no gun that they've got, they didn't have any gun. And even if they did, you're going to blast them away? That's the way this works in America? Really? Open carry states? Even if it's not an open carry state, your first resort is to end someone's life? That's a death culture. That's a death system. It's immoral. It's inhumane. It ain't right. And you've got to start speaking up about it. Not just on social media either. If you confront an attitude out here that's of indifference, you need to confront that attitude and open your mouth and say something to those people. I don't care what happens. Obviously, I care about if someone pulls out a gun at you, which I hope they don't do. But I'm telling you, because people are so sick and evil, some people. Obviously, if someone looks really unhinged, then you're not going to have a dialogue with someone like that. But if someone comes up to you or someone says something, you know what to do. Educate people. Even if they don't want to be educated. If they don't, make sure you say what you have to say and move on. But in a pandemic, you've got to be careful about that. Because again, you got people who won't put on a bloody mask. They won't get vaccinated. You probably have people in your family who won't get vaccinated. And if you do, what do you say to people like that? We've got to start speaking up. We have to. We have to. Columbus has had a whole history of this. This didn't start last week. This has been a whole history. And it's not just Columbus. It's police departments all over the country. This ain't about reform. We don't need a damn reform. I don't care how many black or white or anybody else talks about this, politicians or not. This isn't about reform. This is about a system that kills us and is designed to. It's working the way it was designed to work. Stop talking about it being broken. It ain't broken. We haven't broken this system at all because it's still operating the way it's been operating. The enslavement patrols are still going on. Whole history of this in Columbus. Minnesota and Minneapolis in the city of Minnesota, the twin cities, Minneapolis and St. Paul in the state of Minnesota, they've long had a history. The whole state has a history of this. The Attorney General of this country, United States Attorney General Merrick Garland, is opening up an investigation into the Minnesota Police Department. That's a good place to start. He's got 49 other states to start investigating their departments. And all the municipalities in those states as well. He's going to be one busy attorney general these next 4 years. Jacksons with Be Not Always, and that was, of course, Michael Jackson there. That's from the Victory album, Victory, V-I-C-T-O-R-Y, in case it somehow didn't come across clearly in my pronunciation, Victory. That is the name of the album by the Jacksons that came out back, I think, in the 1980s, to the best of my recollection, Be Not Always. And that we are always, though, in a system that does not care about black and brown people, doesn't care about us. It doesn't. Doesn't care about us voting, doesn't want us to. Doesn't want us to get Medicare for all. Doesn't want us to get equal opportunity to jobs, housing, real estate market. Doesn't give us proper medical care. It's a death system. Take 2 aspirin and die in the morning. That's what black women are constantly told without being told. Oh, you have a pain threshold. You don't feel pain. It's the same bloody thing that Eric Nelson was arguing in the Derek Chauvin murder trial for his defendant client. George Floyd, he is superhuman. He didn't feel any pain. No difference between what Eric Nelson was arguing in that trial and the medical profession that says that to black women and black people in general on a daily basis. No difference. No difference. It's part of a system that kills black and brown people. It's a system. So I do caution those who are jumping up and down, if you are, who are jumping up and down about one verdict, that we still don't know the full ramifications of yet. Because that verdict doesn't mean much of anything if Derek Chauvin in June of 2021 gets sentenced to 5 years in prison, or 10 years in prison, or 12 years in prison, and time off of that for good behavior, if he's going to behave well. He's in prison right now. And he's going to be in prison for the next 8 weeks. If he does cartwheels and kisses the rings of every person in that prison, there's a fair chance that that 2 months is going to be taken off his sentence for good behavior. And that might be imputed to any sentence at all. It's really something to think about. I don't think we really should be celebrating anything. It is the province of George Floyd's family to do what they wish to do. They are the ones who suffered this horrifying, heartbreaking loss, this hole in their heart. So they have the prerogative to respond and act as they see fit and choose to. There is the George Floyd Memorial Foundation. I would donate to that. I really would. I hope you do. If you've got a few dollars in your coffers, please do. That would be a good thing to do. And I don't know if M’khia Bryant has a GoFundMe page, and of course with GoFundMe pages, you've got to be careful with those because they've got to be authentically done. Now, the ones with the Asian families were, you could tell it was done, but you need to get in touch with these, well, I don't know. I mean, once I find out, I will let you know if I'm able to find out about what you can do to donate money. You should be able to donate money, as I said, to the people who shout about how much they care about black girls and, oh, she was going to attack a black girl. Like, you care about black girls. You don't give a rat's ass about black girls. Those people out there who go on social media and say, oh, you don't care about black girls. Because you would have been outraged about the murder of a black girl named M’khia Bryant. You would have been outraged. Prince with Baltimore. And by the way, oh dear me, Prince, 5 years ago on this day, April the 21st, it was actually a Wednesday, would you believe? As is today, Wednesday, April 21st, 2021. 5 years ago, I believe it was Wednesday, could have been a Thursday, April the 21st, 2016. The man we know as Prince died, and it was horrible. Apparently, a fentanyl overdose. Like so many greats, overdosing on drugs. It's so sad. You know, Prince was one of those rare human beings on this planet who really was not only ahead of his time, he was ahead of this planet in the way of his genius musicianship, his creativity, and his intellect. He seemed to really transcend something. He really was someone who refreshingly defied description. Yes, he was a genius, as I said. Yes, he was this androgynous person, or at least that's how I perceived him, and I think people in society did, and there's nothing wrong with androgyny at all. I'm saying that as an observation rather than anything earth-shattering or, ooh, this is bad. No, I'm not saying that. That's good, good. You know, he's embracing who he is, right? He's tapping into the dimensions and aspects of himself as a human being, right? And it's not all one gender or all one thing, right? It's something deeper that he manifests. And he was ahead of the planet in that regard and in all those kinds of regards. This is somebody that planet Earth really, I don't want to say didn't know what to do with. They appreciated him. Many billions of people on the planet Earth appreciated Prince, loved Prince, adored Prince, just like the song goes, adore, adored him. But there were the powers, like the Warner Brothers studios, that, you know, they didn't care about Prince. They cared about how much money they could make off of Prince. And that's where you saw Prince say, you know what, hell no. I'm a slave to you, so I'm going to write slave on my face, and I'm going to record these albums as the artist, or the artist formerly known as Prince. Right? Taff Cap. That was his name. That was his acronym. The artist formerly known as Prince. Or the hieroglyph that was unpronounceable. It was described as the love symbol. So Prince was an activist too, which is not often said about him. That song that you just heard, an excerpt from Baltimore, was an example of that activism. Prince was a very active person. He was an active person. He was an activist. Active in his songwriting and his musicianship, obviously. He wrote thousands of songs, some of which are just being released now in previously unreleased catalogs of material. But this guy was ahead of his time. And he was an activist. He had done other songs. For example, the song Radical Man 2046, I believe, or 2049, which appeared in Spike Lee's film Bamboozled. Listen to that song and tell me that Prince wasn't an activist. Prince was a remarkable, remarkable soul, and all the descriptions in the world about Prince still will not encapsulate just who he was. I think one word that might is boundless. Boundless. Prince absolutely knew no bounds. And that's a compliment to him, not a pejorative. Prince was just out of this world. And again, we will not see the likes of someone like him again. And that's what makes this 5-year mark all the more sad. But there's also a moment for us to celebrate him, as we should, because I think that Prince is, in my view, the greatest musician that ever lived, short of Jimi Hendrix. I think both of those two are the greatest guitarists whom have ever lived. And Jimi Hendrix is still light years ahead and was still light years ahead of Prince in that area. Some people will say Les Paul. I would not say Les Paul. I would say Jimi Hendrix, and I would say Prince after that, a distant second, but still light years ahead of most of the rest. Some would say Eddie Van Halen, and he was very good. He's no longer with us either, but I would still put him a distance behind Prince. Only Jimi Hendrix was better at the kind of genius musicianship that Prince represented. And Prince took his styles from people like Jimi Hendrix, from Jackie Wilson, from James Brown, from Little Richard. And he paid homage to them. He respected them. And he was a very generous human being too, by the way. Very humble and very generous. Providing platforms to all kinds of groups that he collaborated with. Was someone who was very humble, very down to earth. Someone who really believed that conversations had to be important and not about small talk. He was not a small talker. In a world where we fill social media with all kinds of inane BS, Prince was someone who believed in the economy of words and in the importance of what a conversation was and what it meant, and that it couldn't be wasted. Conversation and time could not be wasted with small talk and BS. I'm kind of the same way, you know? Time is precious, and the world is out there, and we're swimming in a universe that is both beautiful and unforgiving. And we've got to start opening our mouths and our hearts and our minds and our souls and be more compassionate. As I have often said here, Prince was one of those compassionate souls as well. And he cared about humanity, all of humanity. And he was very much part of the Black Lives Matter movement. And instead of people saying all lives matter, when it is clear that black people are being shot down dead every day in this country by the police, those people who are saying all lives matter should take a good goddamn look in the mirror at themselves and think about what it is they're saying when you've got M’khia Bryant, a Tatiana Jefferson, George Floyd, Eric Garner, Sandra Bland, Philando Castile, Terrence Crutcher, Alton Sterling, Charlena Lyles, Michael Brown, Freddie Gray. Tamir Rice, Rekia Boyd, Tony McDade, Rayshard Brooks, not to mention Jacob Blake Jr. Dante Wright, Adam Toledo. I mean, that's literally over a dozen names. That's about 16 names I just read off the top of my head. The ones I remember, and I didn't even get to a fraction of the ones over the last few years of black or brown people who have been murdered by the police, killed by the police in the United States. The ones we know of. I had forgotten about Freddie Gray. We can't forget about any of the people who were killed. We can't forget about this. There is only a modicum of relief. And the system of death, a death system, a death culture, a death cult, continues to turn, and the wheels continue to grind, and grind at us. As black people, as brown people. There is nothing to celebrate. We must act, and we must continue to raise our voices and protest. Protest is an American tradition, Judge Bruce Cahill. Just ask Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and Rosa Parks and all of Montgomery, Alabama and the bus boycott. Ask Amelia Boynton, Hosea Williams, John Lewis, Coretta Scott King. Ask them. Protest is American. So Judge Cahill. And these other pathetic people running around here. Get used to it. When you celebrate July 4th about how great and wonderful the United States is and its independence, remember that this country called the US of A was born out of violence and out of protest. And we are protesting peacefully. The vast, vast majority, 94% plus, found to be peaceful. All of these protests regarding Black Lives Matter. So please don't run that garbage over here. It's going to get rejected. And your nonsense is rejected. The system that you worship is telling you the truth about itself. Reform is not the answer. Abolishing the system is. Thank you very much for listening to this edition of The Politicrat. I'm Omar Moore.